Hello and welcome. I'm Jonathan.
And I'm Rob.
And together we are Antique Dust. Woohoo! And everyone was waiting for our next podcast, and it has been a bit of a break.
A little bit of a break.
So, we were thinking about doing All Creatures Great and Small, which is lovely and gorgeous. However, we stumbled across our little DVD collection, and we've decided to do Downton Abbey! Marvellous. So, for those people that have not been around or in prison, lovely. Hope you had a lovely time. The food was great, probably.
Quite a long sentence, though, really, since 2010. But yes. Must have been a serious offence.
Yeah. So, the general story of Downton Abbey, it's about the aristocracy. It starts in 1912, and it's a big stately home. And you've got the upstairs people, which is the Crawleys, and they are the aristocracy, made up of mummy, daddy, three daughters, and grandmama. And then you have all the staff.
They're cooks, downstairs.
So you have like the cook,
the butler,
the housekeeper, maids,
footmen, and
so and all of that lovely regalia and everything. So it's quite a sort of it's fabulous. It's very sumptuous. It's super chill.
Super chill.
It sounds like a visual Mogadon, but it's super interesting and very engaging because there's personality traits from both the aristocracy and the staff. Now, IMDb actually describes this episode. It is 1912. And the news arrives of the sinking of the Titanic.
Ooh.
Yes. I wonder if Kate Winslet still bobbing along on that door. With the loss of the Downton heir, James, and his son, Patrick, the Dowager Countess Violet hopes that the title of the estate will pass on to the current Earl Robert's oldest daughter, Mary. Very contrary. However, Robert decides not to name Mary as the heir, as after discovering that there's a distant cousin...
Sorry, has this synopsis been written by someone who hasn't actually seen the programme? Because none of that is actually correct.
Well, this is IMDb.
Yeah.
This is IMDb.
Yeah.
So we'll scrap the IMDb.
Yeah. I think we'll do our own synopsis in future.
The episode opens with sort of the little tinkling of a piano and people tapping on Morse code. Very exciting. And a train arriving. So the arrival of the train arrives with a message from the Titanic that Titanic has now sunk. And then the house is gradually opening up with the staff doing their staff-like duties. And the postmistress is sort of getting the telegram ready to get sent to the house. I'm basically saying to the postman, saying, well, only go when you drop the post off. There's no point doing it now because no one will be up.
No. Because they're all really, really lazy, and the aristocracy. They lie in bed till gone 8 o'clock of a morning.
I must say, I would have loved to be an aristocracy. Sort of, was very.
You practically are.
Oh,
you
shush
practically
now.
Are.
I have to squeeze my own tea bag and everything. I know it's very, very, very stressful. So the upstairs story is that. The heir, which is the first cousin to
Earl of Grantham.
So
his son.
So Robert's cousin was meant to be inheriting, and the cousin's son, who's also died on the Titanic, was meant to was scheduled in to marry Lady Mary. Yeah.
Should we explain why Mary, the eldest daughter, isn't going to be inheriting anything?
Yes, I think you should explain it.
Okay, so that brings us into an interesting little bit of feudal system era law. And it's called The Entail. So the way that aristocracy works in England is that, with the exception of the royal family, because the law's been changed in that respect, the female line can't inherit the title. However, these days, they can inherit the land and property just like ordinary people can. Mm-hmm. However, back in the dim and distant past, there was a legal process described in the show as the entail, which meant that Earl Robert's ancestors were actually able to enshrine in law effectively that the land and property and the money can only pass down to the person who inherits the title. Now, since a person of the female persuasion is not allowed to inherit the title, therefore they couldn't inherit the money. No longer the case. The entail was actually abolished in English law in the mid-1920s. However, that is some years in the future, mm-hmm. as far as Downton Abbey is concerned. So the quandary for the Crawley family is how to try and keep everything intact, safe, in the family, in inverted commas, and clearly marrying a cousin was probably seen as being the safest way to keep all of this intact. But now, blimey, Jings Crivens help my bulb, that whole thing has now changed because said cousin and son, who was to be Mary's husband, well, they're dead. So what is an aristocratic family to do now?
Because they want to retain the status, the estate, and all that.
And Cora, the American dollar princess's money.
Yeah, which is that's quite interesting, really, because it's the family have standards and worth. However, the family had to have a dollar bride. A dollar princess bride, was it?
Dollar princess. Yes,
a dollar princess, which was a situation where the people that lived in America and that had made all these wealthy sort of people of industry in America that had a lot of money, they wanted the prestige of a title. So they married their daughters off into the aristocracy, the UK aristocracy, so they could get a title and get the prestige.
And the aristocracy get the money.
So obviously the Crawley family, which is sort of not really, well, it's pretty much, obviously it's an obvious situation because they had to marry. He married for the money.
Not for love.
However, it does become apparent within this episode that he does love Cora. So Robert was forced into the marriage, or he married her for the money so they could keep the estate and the standards and what have you. But Cora, unfortunately, only had three daughters and no sons.
No sons, which wasn't anticipated because Cora's money has all been legally bound up into the estate.
And the intel, yeah.
So there's no, you know, so her fortune will go to whoever inherits the title.
I mean, in fairness, it's quite a pleasant sort of dilemma to have. I mean, they've still got their wealth and prestige, yeah. but they're also holding very true the standards and the family commitment and everything, which I think is really very, very lovely.
I mean, the Crawleys aren't poor by
any stretch of imagination.
However, well, they want to hold on, to the money,
yes,
in some way.
So, so Mary obviously is actually not very bothered.
No, she's...
it's clearly, very sad that cousin has died.
Cousins James and Patrick. It's a shame they've died, but clearly that wasn't a love match by any stretch.
Well, no. There's a conversation. There's the three sisters. There's Mary, that's the eldest. You've got Edith, that's the middle one, the blonde one. And then you have
Lady Sybil,
who's quite an innocent and very lovely. Yeah. But
in the first episode, we don't really get to know very much about Sybil. She sort of seems to float about and be concerned and
Yeah.
Defend Edith from Mary's vicious attacks because, and vice versa.
Because so Mary is very attractive, knows her own way, and is probably the golden child.
Yeah.
Edith is the sort of...
Yeah. She's very much suffering from middle child syndrome.
Yeah. So, and every opportunity that Edith gets, she puts the knife in to Mary, and every time she does, she gets twice of it back from
Mary.
From Mary, which is quite, yeah, quite interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. And then Sybil's clearly the baby off the...
So, a little bit of an innocence.
Innocent, probably a bit cosseted.
And as always, she's always looking at the positive, at the positives in situations, because everyone's having to wear mourning. Lady Mary's not really too bothered. Do I have to wear mourning? And it's, well, it was your fiance. Well, it wasn't official a fiance. And there was a bit of a tete-a-tete between Mary and Edith, and that was quite interesting, because Edith said she would have taken him. And sort of Mary said, well, yes, I know you would have. But, yeah, it was very, very dismissive. But Sybil mentioned, well, maybe you say come September, we'll say in August we'll be able to wear a little bit of colour, and then September we'll be able to full colour. Wouldn't that be lovely? And it was just all very, very sweet and very adorable. So we meet Cora. So it's noticeable that sort of Cora and sort of Lord Grantham have got separate bedrooms, and you think, oh, right, what's happening here? But I think that was the thing at the time.
Yes. So we do, in the episode, we do see them sharing the same bed as
well. That's the end of the episode. So, but they've got separate stories. So there was a bit of a question mark to begin with. I know it was like a standard thing for them to have separate rooms. But it was just like, ooh, right, okay. And he knocks to enter. I say hello. It's before he goes in, rather than just walks in, which I thought was quite lovely. But that, as the episode goes on, that the story arc of theirs, they're obviously very, very much a devoted couple. But we meet the dowager
Countess of Grantham. Violet Crawley.
Violet Crawley, played by the inimitable Maggie Smith, who has a put down for everything, but in a very, very polite way. And so the servants come out to, so when they're outside, there's Cora and Lord Grantham that are outside, and said, oh, sort of Mrs. the Duchess is here. And they said, oh no, if you want to speak to Cora, sort of Lady Grantham. So it's like, oh, right. So you get the general feeling that Cora and
the Dowager Countess.
The Dowager and Countess. Right, I will get it right. So we have got six series to cover. Yeah. and they have... So Cora said this one line. So are we friends now? So we're, I think what the term was, we said we're aligning. What was the word? Go on, help me out,
Robert. I can't remember.
So they're on each other's side.
Yeah. I mean, clear. I think what we can glean from it is that they've never been the best of friends, but now, because of the adverse situation, they've sort of been brought together in adversity, and they have to work together now to save the estate from some upstart that they've never heard of, who is the dim and distant relative who will now inherit the title and the land and the property and the money.
Because Robert Crawley has now discovered, knows that there's a male heir, which is a third cousin.
Yeah, so a letter arrives from the solicitor with the detail of the cousin, who clearly they've never met or knew very much of the existence of, but is the closest male relative and therefore is going to inherit.
Yes, but he sort of a bit sniffy because he worked as a doctor.
The solicitor.
the person who's going to inherit, its father was a doctor, and they're a bit sniffy about that. So the person that will inherit is a solicitor in company law. So they're relatively acceptable. Let's say when they were discussing that, they were quite accepting of being a solicitor in company.
They'd have preferred a farmer, probably.
Let's say a gentleman.
A gentleman of the land. His Wellington boots.
So, but the dynamics of the family are quite delicious. We are introduced to a duke that comes along, sniffing around Lady Mary, because he's a fortune hunter.
So he's thinking that with the death of the heir, that the family will try and do something about the entail to secure Lady Mary's position. And clearly the Duke of Crowborough, I think, although a duke is several rungs up the aristocratic ladder from a mere earl, so it'd be a good match in that way for Mary. He very obviously has no money whatsoever. He can't even afford a valet.
So I mean, he arrives at the house and says, "Oh, thank you ever so much for putting me up," and makes an excuse and says, "Oh, my valet is taken ill.
My man
is taken ill," and he gets sort of offered one of their footmen, which when we're sort of, so we'll get on to the staff.
We'll talk about that in a moment.
So Lady Mary is quite enamoured with the Duke.
Yes.
And offers to show him around.
Sounds like they have a little bit of history.
Yes.
From previous encounters.
And I think she's quite enamoured with him. I don't know why, because he seemed a little bit oily. But maybe it was because someone that she could potentially choose rather than being chosen for her.
Mm-hmm.
So she offers to go for a walk around the grounds, and he said, "Oh no, let's go and explore and have an adventure around the house.
Mm-hmm.
Let's look at all the nooks and crannies
and the attics."
So they go upstairs with the attics. That's where the servants' quarters are. And so she shows her where the females live, and then they open the door to the gentlemen's quarters.
Which only Mrs. Hughes, the housekeeper, is allowed to open that door.
Yes. But they open it up, and then he starts going into the footman, who we know is Thomas's room. And they're going like, "Oh, don't do that.
He starts raking through Thomas's underwear.
Mm-hmm. And then they get stopped by the new valet of Robert Crawley's new valet. And he says, "Oh, would you like to have an explore in my room?" And then they quickly scurry off. Which is all a bit peculiar.
Well, Mary's very shamefaced. Clearly she knows they've been caught out in something wrong.
And so, and news of this goes down at the dinner party, that it goes down and it's discussed that they were up in the quarters around the table by Edith,
who
likes to have a bit of a stir at the best of times. And she's a bit shamefaced, and sort of the Duke stays behind after the ladies leave the table, and they're having a conversation with the lovely Robert Crawley about the entails. And then Robert puts him right and says, "Well, nothing's changing.
Mary's status is not going to change. She'll still not be inheriting any of the money."
Yes.
And then as quick as a flash,
he suddenly
loses interest,
because Robert calls him out and say, because he knows he's a fortune hunter. So,
though, as we know, Robert is also was a fortune hunter. So he takes one to know one.
Yeah.
I suppose.
Yeah. So it was very, very obvious, and it's something which obviously Robert does not like at all. Puts him in place very politely. And then Lady Mary gets snubbed because the Duke goes upstairs.
And clearly does not wish to associate any further with someone as poverty-stricken
Yes, which is
the Crawleys,
which is very, very interesting, and that's where we have the Edith and Mary. It's quite a delicious scene with Edith saying to Mary, and say, "Well, the bait's come off the hook," and Mary turns around as quick as you like, say, "Well, at least I've got something to bait my hook with." Delicious. Ooh. It's a very gentle. Yo. It's a very, very gentle. It's not like a RuPaul Drag Race sort of put down. And no.
But it's gentle but pointed nonetheless.
Very, very pointed, which I thought was just so delicious. So we get to that sort of stage. We're introduced to the below stairs sort of team. So we've got Mrs. Patmore, who is the cook. Daisy, that is the young lowest level servant girl.
Yes.
And so the kitchen is run with
precision,
deliberate, and everything. You've got the head butler. We've got the butler, which is by Charles Carson. He's been with the family for absolutely years. And then you have Mrs. Hughes, played by the lovely Phyllis Logan, who was Lady Jane in Lovejoy. Oh, yes. Fabulous.
There's a few podcasts available from on our channel.
We've got a few episodes of Lovejoy
under our belt.
Yeah, so we're introduced to the rankings of the staff, and they also follow the rules and regulations of what they should do and what they are doing, and so their importance in the house. So the hierarchy, Mrs. Patmore in charge of the kitchen, Mrs. Hughes is in charge of
housekeeping.
The butler's in charge of
everything,
and the sort of the serving and the dining and all the staff. And then you've got a range of maids. So you've got ladies' maids. So Lady Mary's got a ladies' maid, Anna, and the lovely Cora. She's got, what's her name?
Miss O'Brien.
Miss O'Brien.
Yeah.
Who's her?
Yeah. So it's one of these, one of these peculiarities. Who gets called by their surname? Who gets called by their first name? So Miss O'Brien clearly not only gets called by her surname, she gets the Miss in front of it, and that's because the ladies' maids were very much on the upper echelons, so she didn't have to take part in any of the other household duties. She was exclusively working for Cora. Anna, on the other hand, gets called by her first name because she wasn't exclusively a lady's maid. She that was quite common for the daughters to, in a sense, be allocated a servant to help them. But that's very different from having a lady's maid. So Anna helped out with getting the daughters ready. But she then has her other duties
as well
in the house as well. And she's not a lady's maid proper, so she doesn't get referred to by her surname.
And so we've got Thomas, who's the head footman, who's known as Thomas.
Thomas.
But he had it in his eye for become the valet for Mr. Crawley, Robert Crawley.
Yes.
However, there's a new chap that's arrived. This is the chap that arrived on the train. And that is
Mr.
Bates.
Yeah. And as a valet, he becomes Mr. Bates, and he's not referred to by his
name. Arrived, and he's lame. He's got a stick.
Yes.
And that's a bit of an uproar in the household, staff, because the valet also has to do other duties.
Such as waiting at table when there's a big party on, holding
trays, moving luggage,
up and down stairs,
and everyone looks and thinks, oh right, what's happened here?
Yeah. So why on earth has his lordship employed a lame valet?
And then it becomes very obvious. There's a little bit of history between Mr. Bates and Robert Crawley, because when they were in the forces, it looks like Mr. Bates was his right-hand man and also took an injury, sort of saving him. And so there seems to be a bit of loyalty. And throughout this episode, there's a general frou-haul with the staff, where the staff are feeding back. It's obviously Thomas wanted the job, and he's a bit peeved that his work's going to be harder because he's going to have to pick up the slack from Mr. Bates.
So not only has he been passed over valet, he'll then have to start doing things that the valet
should be doing,
would otherwise be doing, but without getting the presumably the pay increase
and the prestige. And then it also gets fed back with the lady's maid.
We've got Miss O'Brien, who seems to have a very close relationship with Thomas, but her motivation is unclear because she seems to certainly be presenting herself as a bit of a stirrer.
She's a bit of a stirrer. She's a drama monger. She likes a bit of a drama. She lights the wick and then stands back.
Yeah.
And
she's a definite agent of chaos.
Yeah, agent of chaos.
She does seem to enjoy the drama that then ensues.
But she's well respected by Cora, and it looks like she's been the lady's maid for some time, mm-hmm. and so she's very, very established in that job.
And so she's whispering in Cora's ear about Mr. Bates not being up to the job.
Yeah.
Thomas is whispering in Carson's ear.
And then Mr. Carson is whispering in
his lordship's
ear. So it's all a bit. So the lord, his lordship, sort of Robert Crawley, unfortunately, has to say to Mr. Bates, "Look, I've given you a trial. Although he didn't give me that much of a trial. It was like 3 days, if that."
Well, it's hard to. With these things, it's always quite hard to get a sense of the passage of.
Yeah, time. I mean, because I think because we had the so there was some sort of remembrance thing. At the
so
church.
I think quite a bit of time
has passed.
I don't know if it's IMDb or somewhere else that I read, but suggests that this first episode runs from April when the Titanic sunk till August.
Right, because they were wearing colours at the end of it, weren't they? So
I think there's maybe 4 or 5 months. Elapsing in this first episode.
So we're introduced to a number of the staff, but the key thing is that Robert Crawley has to let Mr. Bates down, and then he's going to be on the first train out of it along with the Duke. And at the very end of the episode, he's packed up and ready to go, and Mr. Bates is obviously very upset, and he sort of Anna feels sorry for him because Anna was the person that was nice to him and kind, and you get a spark when they first arrive and the stick, everyone's looking at his leg and his stick.
And he's also set up for a literal fall when the Duke of Crowborough arrives, and just as the Duke is walking past, as the servants are all lined up, then Miss O'Brien kicks away
chewing gravel.
He face plants right into the drive.
Yeah, so...
And Anna is the only one who shows any concern.
And compassion.
And helps him.
And so she's allowed to take a tray of food up, and when she takes a tray of food up to the servant's quarters on the top of the house, she hears him sobbing, and then she's very polite, and she calls out, "Hello!" And there was a really nice little exchange between the two, and said, "Well, please do let me know how you get on, and blah blah blah. Please, right? Otherwise, I'll be worried." Which I thought was really sweet.
Yes,
very, very sweet.
Very nice.
And but basically, Robert Crawley, he sees the error of his ways, and in a fit, stops the car and says, "Right, come out, and we'll think nothing more of it." And you think like, "Oh gosh." But the thing is, Mr. Bates, when he's let down, Robert Crawley says, "I'll continue paying you." So he said, "No, I'm not a charity case. I want to work for my money." Which I think is, it's like he's a very honourable chap.
Mm.
He seems to have been through the ringer, and this was a last chance for him. So the episode ends with that, and it was just actually the episode ends with a lady, an older lady, and a blonde chap having breakfast, and the post is arriving, and
it's a letter from the Earl of Grantham, and the lady says, well, what does he want? And the reply is, to change our lives.
So this is Matthew Crawley and Isabel Crawley, paid by Dan Stevens and Penelope Wilton. And that's how the episode ends. And it's just absolutely delicious.
Right. So do we need to touch upon, if you pardon the expression, the little bit of the plot twist?
Go on.
Off when the Duke of Crowborough retires.
Oh God, I forgot the big thing.
How could you forget that?
Sorry.
That's the main
deliberate
thing.
Deliberate mistake, listeners. Yeah. So there is the story is that Thomas, who's a bit of a nasty piece of work, he's a bit of a stirrer.
Yeah.
He's obviously been a bit sideswiped by Mr. Bates arriving. And he is the valet to, he's just like the temporary valet to the Duke while he's in the house. And it becomes apparent that the Duke and Thomas have had a little bit of
a romantic
assignation, or a more than that, because the Duke has written lots of letters, which is another reason why he was rifling through his underwear
drawer. I think that was the main reason why he was rifling through his underwear drawer, to get his hands on
these letters,
all these incriminating love letters.
Because he's been writing love letters to Thomas, and Thomas was the person that instigated him to arrive to woo Lady Mary.
Because Thomas disappears mysteriously, sort of midway through the episode, and Carson explains his absence as he asked to, if it could just pop into the village. But it turns out that he popped into the village to send a telegram to the Duke of Crowborough, letting him know about the change in fortunes of the family with the death of the heir.
Given a heads up, which sort of issued the visitation of the Duke. And there's a bit of a sort of a tussle, and the Duke has the letters. If I was the Duke and I was trying to get the letters, I would have burnt the letters.
Burnt them straight away.
I burnt them straight away.
But that's not very dramatic.
So he throws the letters in, and Thomas likes to have his cards close to his chest, and he was going to use it as a bargaining tool.
Yeah. There was a bit of blackmail sort of coming the Duke's way, clearly.
Yes. Looking back in the history books, the valets, many, many times, the aristocracy were of a lavender persuasion, had the valets, and the valets were the lover, but it was an accepted thing with the gentleman and the valet. I think that obviously the Duke to Thomas has got everything, and more money than Thomas is ever going to get, but in society the Duke has no money. And Thomas is a nice diversion, because the Duke just says, well, no one's got to forgive a couple of weeks in the season. But there was a lot of letters.
There was a lot of letters. There was a surprising bundle of letters. But I guess maybe just the Duke was a bit of a romantic, who knows. But what we do learn very quickly is that the Duke's off to America to get himself a dollar princess.
A dollar princess.
And Thomas is kicked to the curb.
Yes.
Because there's no place in a Duke's life.
Well, the Duke's reputation would be solid if it came out that he was of the lavender persuasion, which is quite sad. And I think it's a really nice...
But what we also learned, of course, is that the Thomas is off the... As you so
lavender
charmingly
persuasion.
Put it, of the lavender persuasion.
Yes.
So that's setting up lots of interesting things to happen in the future.
It is, and it's a really good thing, because if you think of it like a period piece, it's quite, although having sort of gay characters or trans characters in sort of stories is quite sort of accepted in contemporary, but it's quite interesting having this done for a period piece. And yeah. It does feel, although this was done for a commercial channel, it does feel like a BBC drama. It really does. Yeah. It has
your prejudices are showing.
Yeah, my prejudices are showing. I mean, cause I for years I always thought
Brideshead Revisited that was made by Granada.
I know, and it nearly killed them because the finances of that cost a frigging fortune, but it's absolutely glorious.
Yeah, well, that's why, you know,
I always wanted a teddy bear called Aloysius.
Yeah, that's why there's so little period drama shot these days, because it is just so
costly,
mega expensive. And if they do it, they do it in the way that at Downton Abbey is done, which is by doing as much location work as they can. And then in the show, it is only the downstairs and like the kitchen
that is a
standing set. Everything else is done on site, because it's just cheaper to do it that way. The old days of a bit of external shooting and all the internal work to being done in a studio, that's just not the way that television is made these days.
No, and but it is just so delicious. And the creator of the series has also done, they did try to do a period hotel series that went for one series, but then
was that Crossroads?
No, it wasn't Crossroads. No. So that there was, it had one series so far, and it's set in the Gilded Age. It's called the Gilded Age.
Yeah, that's not about a hotel, but.
No, but there was a hotel one that was done, which in the UK, a period hotel, which went for one series by the same creator. But the Gilded Age is the precursor to the pound, the dollar princesses.
Yeah, I mean, the Gilded Age, we assume, is sort of set in the same universe as Downton Abbey, but at an earlier point in time. So it's late 19th. Century, and it's set in New York.
Yeah, and I think there was talk that they were going to do a bit of a crossover with a younger
Violet Crawley.
What, Violet Crawley?
Yeah,
going out there.
I think that was more wishful thinking than anything that Julian Fellowes had planned to do. I mean, it's theoretically possible that Violet Crawley went to America at some point when she was a young lady, but yeah, who knows? Yeah. Maybe the seed's been sown.
That's very delicious as well. So we may cover that one as well. But we've got delicious.
We've
Downton.
Got a few episodes of Downton.
We've got a fair few, six series, a number of Christmas specials, and two movies. Films. So we have got a lot to go at, folks. So if anyone out there that is listening has any tidbits,
anyone
listening, knock knock knock. So if anyone out there has any tidbits, Downton tidbits, trivia, anything like that, please do inbox us.
Anyone who wants to correct our numerous
errors
and ongoing errors, because we love the research, don't we?
Yeah, we do lots of research.
We're mad for
Google,
the research.
Google bots, it's amazing. So we're on all social media platforms at Antique Dust, and please like, subscribe, share the hell out of everything. It'd be delicious. There is over 100 other episodes of other delicious periods.
And they're all as good as this one, if not better.
Well, we've got Bergerac, we've got Howard's Way, we've got Little Lovejoy.
Yeah. And we've got movies. We cover movies too.
No, we do movies, yeah. We may be doing another movie, because it's coming up to Eurovision time. And so if you're listening to this in real time, then the Eurovision is...
Small hint.
Ta-da! Anyway, folks, it's farewell from me, Jonathan.
And it's goodbye from me, Rob.
Bye-bye.
Bye.